With a crescent moon illuminating the New Jersey sky, the graduate final was staged at the Meadowlands. To date, the age pacing division has been highly competitive, with covert action and the always tough Jake and Elwood challenging the supremacy of last year's divisional champion, Dorunrun Bluegrass. We'll travel to the Bluegrass from which Dorunrun came and meet Dr. Luel Overstreet, the man who has orchestrated the brilliant career of the five-year-old pacer. Dr. Overstreet is a veterinarian who breeds and trains standardbred on his own track at Bluegrass Farm. And we'll update you on three horses. First, center court, the two-year-old we met as a foal. Then the three-year-old Die Laughing, who made his seasonal debut. And finally, the incomparable filly Miss Easy, who is gearing up for a showdown with the boys. Hello again, everyone. I'm Bruce Beck. Welcome to another edition of Harness Racing 91. Well, after five exciting legs of the graduate, it was time for the big test, the $200,000 final at the Meadowlands Racetrack. The race, which brings together the finest free-for-allers in North America, has been contested since 1978, and the race has figured prominently in year-end divisional honors, with five of the race's winners going on to be seasonal champions. And the roster reads like a who's who of harness racing greats. In 1980, the third year of the series, the Rex Scooter captured the event. In 1983, Cam Fella set a new stakes record en route to Horse of the Year honors. In 1986, Forrest Skipper duplicated Cam Fella's efforts. In 1988, two-time Breeders' Crown champion Call for Rain graduated with honors. And 1 year ago, and it was Dorunrun Bluegrass. Storm, it deserves another look.
There goes TK Skipper, middle of the track, with Dorunrun Bluegrass. Around the first turn, and Dorunrun Bluegrass has the lead by a length and a half. Top Notcher is second on the outside, Storm Compensation. TK Skipper is fourth. Then a length and a half, Fiorella Blue Chip. Another two back barely visible. Long the rail, Princely Cam with Ticket to Heaven. Then after that, Dare You Too, Timberjack and Chernobyl, 27 and 4 for the first quarter. Down the backstretch and Dorunrun Bluegrass. Put away the challenge of Storm Compensation as Top Notcher gains along the rail. TK Skipper is in fourth. Gaining along the inside, Princely Cam. Fiorella Blue Chip in sixth. Then it's barely visible with Ticket to Heaven. After that, Timberjack with Dare You Too and Chernobyl. They go by the half, and here comes TK Skipper to take on Dorunrun Bluegrass. 55 and 4 for the half. Dorunrun Bluegrass not giving up that lead. TK Skipper on the outside second. Some hard ball from Ron Pierce. Top Notcher is third with Fiorella Blue Chip, the outside fourth. Barely visible in fifth. Ticket to Heaven in sixth. They're by three quarters and 1:23 and one. They're on their way home. Dorunrun Bluegrass continues to lead. TK Skipper is right there. Top Notcher looks for racing room. Dorunrun Bluegrass with TK Skipper. Dorunrun Bluegrass is not giving it up. A wire-to-wire winner.
This year, Dorunrun Bluegrass looked to become the first pacer to capture back-to-back graduates. But to do it, he had to contend with late bloomer Covert Action and honor student Jake and Elwood. We'll have highlights of the 1991 graduate final coming up shortly. Harness Racing 91 is brought to you by Budweiser, the king of beers, who reminds you, friends know when to say when. And by Harness Racing Communications. Owners of harness horses come from all walks of life. Some are trainers, others are businessmen. Some approach it as an investment, while others chase that once-in-a-lifetime dream of fielding a champion. And then there's Dr. Luel Overstreet, a multidimensional individual who combines a little bit of everything. Bluegrass Standardbred Farm, owned and operated by Dr. Luel Overstreet. Over the years, he has risen in stature in the harness racing industry. From modest veterinary roots, he's developed a highly successful farm of horses. The operation is now in its fifth decade.
Started with the harness horses about 1967 with a couple of race horses, and then bought some brood mares. And the first stallion I purchased was a little good time horse by the name of Main Rival. And he stood here at the farm for several years. And then I acquired a Meta Skipper stallion, Sir Carlton. In fact, I think he was out of the first crop of Meta Skipper and was probably the first son of Meta Skipper to stand in the state of Kentucky.
Among those who have been a part of the highly successful bluegrass tradition is Samshoe Bluegrass, 1986 age pacing mare of the year and a winner of the Breeders' Crown.
The horse that won the Breeders' Crown, Samshoe Bluegrass, I purchased her at Tattersall's. I did not buy her. She was a South Majority mare, and she won the Breeders' Crown about 7 years ago, I guess. And we've had some nice racehorses, not outstanding racehorses, over the years. Dorunrun Bluegrass probably being the best one that I've had. Not probably, he has been the best one that I've had. We have some more nice horses in the stable right now. We think we have a nice crop of two-year-olds.
At the top of the stretch, Colburn Action! Dorunrun coming out of the outside! Colburn Action and Dorunrun! Colburn Action! Dorunrun Bluegrass! He is gonna get the job done of the graduate! 154-3! It ties the track record set last year!
Well, we would be happy if Dorunrun Bluegrass could repeat the year this year that he had last year. He made about $850,000 last year, was voted age pacer of the year.
One of the reasons for Dorunrun Bluegrass's success, his own training track on the farm.
We train just our own horses. We don't train any outside horses, so we don't really have to please anybody but ourselves. All my horses are trained on a 3/8 mile track. I prefer training on the small track over a mile track. We feel like when we leave this 3/8 mile track, we can go to any racetrack in the country and race. So obviously, if a horse can perform on a 3/8 mile, he can perform on a half or a 5/8 or a mile. So that's my theory.
Dr. Overstreet doesn't limit his interest in animals to those of the equine variety. He has a true feel for all animals. His veterinary practice has been going strong for close to 30 years.
Well, I've been practicing in the same office since 1964. Our practice has changed considerably over the years. At one time, I had the largest beef cattle and hog practice in the state, and this part of the country has changed a lot in the last 30 years, and farmers having trouble getting help, so it's mainly corn and soybeans now, so that's changed. And we do, my practice now is small animal and equine, and the practice is doing great. Have all the work that I can do.
Will Dr. Overstreet enjoy success on the racetrack in the future? Only time will tell. But for him, the future is not a concern. Right now, he's content doing what he loves best, being around animals, racing the strong ones, and healing the weak.
I have two sons. One of them is somewhat interested in the business. The other one is not interested. At this stage, I don't know whether the one son will want to continue in the business and continue the farm or not. If he doesn't, that's fine with me. We'll continue breeding and racing as long as I have fun doing it, and right now we're having a good time.
And when we come back, we'll find out if Dr. Luel Overstreet had any fun as his horse Dorunrun Bluegrass looked to become class valedictorian in the graduate.
It's the graduate final, one of harness racing's top early season stakes races. The top older pacers in North America have gathered here at the Meadowlands for this mid-May test of divisional supremacy. Now, there's no question Dorunrun Bluegrass is shot to the top of his class, but he'll face a tough field in this final exam. Covert Action will leave from the two-hole inside of Dorunrun Bluegrass. The winner of this year's Leaving at Yonkers and Cornell Memorial at Freehold, an overnighter last year, an overnight sensation this year. A second-place finish in the graduate leg at Buffalo earned him a spot in the final.
After the leave, he had three tough races in a row. He won them all by noses. And Buffalo sort of got his trip with Dorunrun second over, which he can just outbrush my horse. He was awesome that night. We tied the track record, in fact. And last week, I was racing Covert off the rail there. I got him fired up a little too much, and I shut his air off, letting Jake and Elwood go, and he's kind of empty at the half. But I sort of suspect he'll race pretty good tonight.
Jake and Elwood is perhaps the most consistent in the field. This four-year-old has been in the money in 8 out of 8 in 91, and sports one of Harness Racing's best owner-trainer-driver combinations. Lou Gaida's the owner, Ken Sieber the trainer, John Campbell's in the bike.
Dorun's really come on strong as of late. He wasn't quite himself the first couple of races when we raced against him in the offers, but he's a warrior and he's back to form.
Tell us about your horse's consistency.
He's just a professional. He goes out and goes his race every time. He's never gone a bad race in his life. He doesn't win every race, but they know he's in there every time he goes behind the gate.
What are some of your plans for the graduate final?
Win it.
Prince Ebony retired 5 years ago, but he's back. As an 8-year-old, he's come on to win 18 races in the last 2 years, 4 of his last 7 at the Meadowlands. Having won last year's graduate with Dorunrun Bluegrass, driver Ron Pierce will try to take Prince Ebony to this year's winner's circle. We've already met Dorunrun Bluegrass, the 1990 Age Pacer of the Year and the defending champ at the graduate. Will the 5-year-old become Harness Racing's valedictorian?
He's as good as any one of them. He only needs the break of the race. You know, like I said, you know, if he gets the right break of the race, the right pace, you use him at the right time, he's as good as anything. But like I said, he looked awful good. He became number one the last 2 weeks when Jacob Elwood was not in the race. So Jacob Elwood, I feel, is definitely the horse to beat.
A speed battle could result in an upset of Dorunrun Bluegrass, the people's choice at 4-5. Ticket to Heaven won a graduate leg at Freehold. He's at 30-1. Pipsqueak's been sharp lately, finishing second last week at Bluebonnets. One thing's for sure, the start will be crucial as the race takes shape.
And they're off. Covert action for the lead. Quickly, though, on the outside, there goes Jake and Elwood. Around the first turn, Covert action. On the inside, John Campbell hustles Jake and Elwood up. With Tyler's point in third, Dorunrun Bluegrass is underway from fourth. Then it's a length and a half to Ticket to Heaven. Another two back, scoot out of reach. With Prince Ebony, 2.5 Pipsqueak, and San Francisco Bend, 27-1 the first quarter. And it's Dorunrun Bluegrass. Now to take over the lead from Jake and Elwood. Covert action in third. Another two back, Tyler's point is fourth. Then it's another two, Ticket to Heaven fifth. 2.5, scoot out of reach in sixth. Prince Ebony in the seventh spot. Pipsqueak in eighth, and San Francisco Bend. They wheel by the half, and it's Dorunrun Bluegrass by a length. Jake and Elwood in the pocket second. The half in 54-2. Onto the far turn. Dorunrun Bluegrass with a length lead. Jake and Elwood second, Ticket to Heaven. The first over third. Scoot out of reach. Second over fourth with Covert action. Buried on the inside fifth. Prince Ebony, the outside sixth. They go by three quarters and it's Dorunrun Bluegrass with the lead. 1:23-3 for three quarters. They're on their way home. Dorunrun Bluegrass by a length and a half. Jake and Elwood now out of the pocket to challenge. Here comes Scoot out of reach on the outside. Prince Ebony in deep stretch. Jake and Elwood now overtaking Dorunrun Bluegrass. It's got to be Jake and Elwood winning the graduate in 1:51-1.
With three lead changes before the half, Jake and Elwood seize the pocket behind Dorunrun Bluegrass, allowing him to set the fractions. Driver John Campbell found his spot to get Jake out and overpowered Dorunrun and the rest of the field down the stretch.
Yeah, Jake felt real strong at the head of the stretch. I was a little concerned about getting racing room. There was a horse alongside of me, but he died when Dorun took off. And once we got halfway through the stretch, he felt strong and kind of coasted to the wire.
You get the good trip in the graduate final, but does it make up for some of the bad luck you've had in the past?
Well, luck works out over the period of the year. He's had a little bad luck with some of the bigger races so far, but the year's still young, and he races his heart out every time, and fortunately tonight he just got a good trip and the brakes went his way.
John Campbell is great at taking a negative like starting from the 9-hole and turning it into a positive like toppling the mighty Dorunrun Bluegrass in a stakes record. This division has already given us some great races and there's more to come. Next up, the Battle of Lake Erie in 3 weeks. For Harness Racing 91, I'm Steve Mayer.
The race was everything it was supposed to be, and the new stakes record of 151-1 confirmed it. Congratulations to driver John Campbell for another flawless trip. And so the number one spot in this week's top 10 changes hands once again. This time it's Jake and Elwood's turn.
This.
When you see a racehorse perform on the track, it's easy to take things for granted. But in reality, the rearing, the nurturing, the process of getting a foal ready for racing is a complex and unique exercise.
In harness racing, a two-year-old champion is the realization of every owner and breeder's dream. Camtastic, a son of two-time Horse of the Year Cam Fella and the stakes-winning mare Lushkara, was such a champion. Virtually flawless at two, he capped his freshman season with a Breeders' Crown title and Pacer of the Year honors.
The fantastic Camtastic, 156-2.
When a foal is born, he or she is the carefully selected product of bloodlines and genealogy, hopefully combined with such qualities as heart, speed, and stamina. Those questions will be answered later, but during these first carefree months, every foal is a potential champion. One such blue blood is Center Court. Raising and breeding standard breds is a chancy business. One way to cut the odds is to buy the offspring of champions who have already produced winners. Nick Colinaro did just that.
Now, all the times I saw his full brother raise Camtastic, yes, it was very impressive. And when I looked at him, I went over him, and I liked everything I saw about him except for his size, and I really didn't knock too much of that because, I figured he'll grow in time anyway. And if he just grew a little bit, I'm satisfied, and the way he's grown, the size he is now, I like the size he is right now. He's a flighty kind of horse, I guess. It just takes after his family because he would see a tractor and go clean across the racetrack sideways and didn't care who was in his way. He went through three jog carts before he's still a little bit, but he's getting a lot better.
Selecting a yearling is just the first step in the long process of developing a champion. 7 months later, after careful training, conditioning, and some well-placed luck, Center Court is in the final stages of prepping for his racing debut, and one precaution trainer Nick Colinaro took was to choose a driver familiar with many members of this colt's family.
I used to drive a Lushkara, the dam of Camtastic, and Loving Proof, and she was a very nice mare. She had a record of 54 and a piece or something like that. And every foal she had so far, they all made the races, and they all pretty good horses there. Especially Camtastic was a top horse there. And it's just fun to see him, improve every week. And that was the first time this morning that I got behind that colt there, but he showed a lot of ability.
Center Court is on the verge of beginning his career. He carries the hopes of his connections along the way. And for now, the future looks bright. Only time will tell if he can fulfill his destiny.
Racing a two-year-old is always full of surprises, some pleasant, some disappointing. As Center Court's racing career unfolds, we'll follow the twists and turns. Meanwhile, two of last year's two-year-old sensations, Die Laughing and Miss Easy, are back at it. Their story next on Harness Racing 91.
You won't want to miss the Grand Circuit in Lexington this fall, including the Grand 500 Yearling Sale, the Tattersall's Pace, and the Kentucky Futurity. You'll love the pace.
You love the pace. You love the pace. It's the Red Mile.
This.
The three-year-old pacing picture is coming into focus. As Die Laughing, last year's runner-up in divisional honors, made his 1991 debut. In the next 8 weeks, he'll be racing for purses worth $2.5 million, a stakes-laden road full of riches. In 2 weeks, it's the final for the $500,000 New Jersey Classic. 2 weeks after that, it's up to Greenwood Raceway in Toronto, Canada, for the eliminations of the June 22nd $1 million North America Cup Final. And just 3 weeks later, another million is up for grabs in the Meadowlands Pace.
And they're off. On the far outside, there goes Nuke of Earl bidding for the lead with Handsome Nuke from between horses. Die Laughing away third around the first turn. And on the outside, it's Nuke of Earl. The inside, Handsome Nuke, another length and a half to Die Laughing. Then it's 2.5 to Hooligan. Up on the outside, Racy Masquerader with Ask. Another 2.5 to LD's Wally. Then after that, Lethal with Sound Machine and Sea King Lobel trails. 27-4 the first quarter. And it's Nuke of Earl by a length and a half. Racy Masquerader parked out second. Handsome Nuke in third. Die Laughing in the fourth spot. Another 2.5 to Hooligan fifth. That's Lethal, the outside sixth. Another length back to Ask in seventh. Then it's Sea King Lobel. After that, it's Sound Machine and LD's Wally. The half in 57-2. It's Nuke of Earl. As Racy Masquerader parked out, as Handsome Nuke moves to an opening on the inside. Die Laughing is forced three wide around Racy Masquerader. Midway around the final turn, Nuke of Earl, by 3/4 of a length. Joined now by Die Laughing. Another length and a half to Handsome Nuke. 3/4, 125-4. They're on their way home. Nuke of Earl with a short lead. On the outside, Die Laughing in deep stretch. It's Die Laughing now with the lead by 2.5. It's going to be Die Laughing winning this one. Up on the outside, Lethal gets second to time. 1:54.
Die Laughing pulled three wide at the 5/8 in pursuit of the pace setter, Nuke of Earl, and collared him in the stretch. Coasting home in 154 flat under mild urging. The first step, a winning one.
I was very pleased with him. It's his first start. It's the first start of his three-year-old career where he wore an open bridle tonight. He was a little green. We're expecting good things from him, and this race was really just used as a prep for the oncoming races to come.
Last year's superstar pacing filly and divisional champion Miss Easy has already made her presence known, as she qualified at the Meadowlands with an impressive 155 flat performance, merely a prep for what lies ahead. A prep race indeed. It was simply the sensational Miss Easy and driver John Campbell racing against the clock in the morning qualifier. The filly literally strutted her stuff as she paced down the stretch with the greatest of ease, proving to all that with maturity and experience, her dazzling 1990 season could only be enhanced. And even trainer Bruce Nichols was impressed.
She was getting home strong, and John said the speed's there. Just a matter of her getting in shape, and, you know, there's nothing better than a race. You can train. Qualifiers are not that impressive, but, you know, we're getting about ready to go to work now. And she's going to start here on the 27th, the last leg of the New Jersey Sires. Hopefully I can get enough points to go in the final, but I want to keep her here at the Meadowlands for the first 5 or 6 starts, because, you know, we got something down the road we're pointing for.
As of now, Miss Easy is aiming for a showdown with the top colts in the $1 million Meadowlands Pace on July 12th. And, you know, owner Lou Gaida has never been afraid to take a star filly and campaign her against the best colts in the sport. Remember when Peace Corps won the Breeders' Crown and Lou boldly and correctly predicted she would race the boys in the Hamiltonian? Well, after watching his star filly, Miss Easy, qualify so impressively, Lou hinted at the possibility of moving up Miss Easy's schedule. The thought was that it might even happen in the New Jersey Classic. But after conferring with trainer Bruce Nichols and driver John Campbell, the trio agreed to postpone the imminent meeting and go back to the original schedule. We will certainly look forward to the head-to-head encounter. Another development this week in the Gaida stable is the acquisition of star trotting filly Santa Royale. Last year, she showed great promise at 2, and this year, she's one of her division's top contenders. The night Die Laughing qualified at the Meadowlands also showed us how dangerous the sport of harness racing can be. Watch the left of your screen as Tough Sir, driven by Jim Meittinis, took a bad step and stumbled, forcing the horse Cam Wynn, driven by Jack Moiseyev, to go right up their backs. It was a frightful moment, but fortunately, neither driver nor horse were seriously injured. You know, many times driving a racehorse seems all too commonplace, but at 35 miles per hour, it can be an extremely dangerous situation. Next week, we'll have the Courier and Ives Trot from Ladbroke at the Meadows near Pittsburgh. and will catch up with last year's world record holder, Arch Place, as he begins his 91 campaign. I'm Bruce Beck. Thanks for joining us. See you next week. Harness Racing 91 has been brought to you by Harness Racing Communications.